ride your files all the way back to Washington. I'd be lying if I said I was gonna miss you.
The investigation isn't over. You have absolutely nothing on Mars.
Mars is guilty. Case closed. Anyway, it's no concern of yours. Now you're off the case. So pack up and fuck off.
I guess Mars is guilty because he ran from the police.
You are an unbalanced, psychopathic asshole.
I'll take that as a compliment.
Come on, fight.
Honestly, I don't give a shit what you think.
I want to do the final boss fight against
killer. Everyone's happy.
Detective Blake.
Story. Have a nice trip back. No harm in it.
Grab him right by the beard. Tear him a new beard hole. A new beard hole. He needs to be high so we can focus on solving this case.
The killer's name is here. Somewhere in this data. I just have to find it. Find it before it's too late.
Oh, one last thing, sir. You should be careful not to over-indulge.
He's gonna die of an overdose after this case is over.
He'll end up killing you if you're not careful. That would be most unfortunate, sir.
These are the same two files that we've had the whole game, so we don't need these. Clear all. Clues. There must be some new clues. Tire tracks.
Ari was in the courtroom when I was fighting with the killer. Perhaps there's something on
it. When he was fighting with the killer, yes. Now he's gonna figure it out, for sure. There's Scotty Boy, wearing his Dick Tracy hat. He grabs the samurai sword off the wall and makes these really fake-looking swings like he's shadowboxing. It really, really looks like the killer is not actually trying to kill Jayden, he's just trying to scare him. Rewind forward. I can rewind the footage and watch it backward. I can also pause. Can I rewind to before the position where he started watching? I didn't mean to close that, I wanted to play it. I guess I have to go forward.
Seen this before somewhere.
It was the gold watch that they give to new sergeants in the police department, which is proof that the Origami Killer used to work for the police department. Well, it's proof that
the watch they give for promotions to lieutenant. The killer is a cop.
Okay, promotions to lieutenant. So yes, it's possible that this man could have simply been the accomplice of the Origami Killer, but since we know what Scott Shelby's coat looks like, we pretty much have it, you know, we have him dead to rights. We just need to get the handcuffs on, and then this game will, well, there's the minor detail of saving Sean. Is there anywhere else we can, like, pause and analyze? Maybe the sword? I wanted to freeze it on a frame where the sword was visible.
Nothing to do with the killer.
Oh, it has nothing to do with the killer, okay. There's nothing to analyze in this frame.
Two receipts from the same gas station. Might be near the kill as well.
So now he has to cross-check on former lieutenants of the local police department against some people who live near this gas station. Let's geo-analyze this.
The killer lives in the sun. We're doing way too many to live around there. Not good enough. Gotta find a means of identifying the killer more precisely.
Just look at who lives around there who used to work for the police department. If there are like a bunch of them, look at who was ranked lieutenant or higher. Origami figure or trick. The killer is a cop.
Harden Blake! That would explain the dead-end investigation and his desire to frame Ethan Mars.
He thinks that Blake did it. Let's investigate further, since we don't think that Blake did it. I would love to start a fight with Blake, but I have to go with my intuition on this. Can we geo-analyze the Blue Lagoon video? Nope. Gas receipts. We already analyzed these.
That doesn't get us anywhere.
I bet I have to go back to the video and I have to rewind or fast forward to like a very specific frame. The killer was a cop, geo-analyze. Yeah, I add the killer was a cop to the other analysis, and then the intersection is that red dot. So that's where the origami killer lives.
He owns a warehouse on the docks. If I'm wrong, Sean Morris is dead.
He owns a warehouse on the docks. Scott does not own a warehouse on the docks. Maybe he does own a warehouse on the docks. I don't really know too much about him. I'm really curious what happens if you accuse Blake. I would replay this game to see all the alternate choices, but I don't think replaying it once is enough. Because I could make a story where, like, you accuse Blake, and that's, like, the crescendo of the story. But then I could make a story where, like, Ethan passes all the trials, and... Alright, so this is the death of John Shepherd. And Scott Shepherd over here is going to try to call his dad probably for help. And his dad is going to be like, ah, humbug. You little buggers always disturbing me while I'm drinking. Mom?
Mom's work is too far
away. Mom's work is too far away.
I'll never make it in time.
Okay.
Hold on, bro. I'll find someone. Dad will come back and save you.
Dad.
Dad, I've got to get Dad. He's the only one who can save John. I've got to move.
Is this Dad right here? He lives in this tiny little trailer next to a construction site? Or is that like a temporary trailer that was erected for the sake of facilitating construction? One less greedy mouth to feed, won't it? There are certain scenes in this game which are really, really predictable.
Please, please.
If you're like paying any attention whatsoever to the implications of like the character's behavior and you know what we already know. Scotty. That confirms it. Scotty Shepherd, aka Scotty Shelby. And actually, Shepherd and Shelby are pretty similar names, so he must not be very creative. Is the Origami Killer. Now I need to stop and think here, because now that it's confirmed that Scott Shelby is the Origami Killer, I have to try to think about what he's been doing all game and what he was trying to accomplish. What was he trying to accomplish by accusing Gordy Kramer of being the Origami Killer? Was he just trying to throw the investigation off of himself by, like, framing someone else? That doesn't seem to make sense since the investigation was never on him. He was never suspected by anyone, except, I guess he's suspected by Madison now, because Madison talked to, the Origami Killer's mother and found out the real last name of, the Foster family. Oh, okay, the Foster family was Shelby, yes, okay. I was saying that Scott Shelby made up a name to go by as an adult, but, the Foster family must have been Shelby, so Scott didn't actually make up jack shit. He just made up a lot of really, disgusting contrived trials for the parents of these other children to go through in order to try to win them back or save them. The final trial is kill yourself, so it's possible that some of the fathers who disappeared actually succeeded at that trial and killed themselves, and that's why they were never seen from again. But all of the boys were dead. So maybe if you kill yourself at the last trial, then the Origami Killer, like, kills your son anyway. Or maybe if you take the poison, it kills you instantly, and you actually don't get 60 minutes to save your son. I'm really glad I didn't take the poison after thinking about this a little longer. But, yeah, Scott Shepherd was adopted by the Shelbys and became Scott Shelby when he was a wee lad of 11 or 10. And his brother, who used to bully him all the time, died by being drowned in rainwater. I assume he was taken away from his parents because his mom said, "I'd lost one son and I was about to lose another son also," because his parents probably weren't willing to admit their guilt in the death of John Shepherd. So they just used John's death as an excuse to hate Scott even more, instead of, like, loving the hell out of Scott because he was the only thing they had left in the world. They, like, were probably too cowardly to blame themselves for the role that they played. So, they thought of some way to make it Scott's fault, and they probably abused him until the abuse became so obvious that Scott was taken away by social services. That's my theory about what happened there. And then, he was raised by the Shelbys, and, he was so messed up that, I don't know what happened. Maybe he became a cop, maybe, he saw some ugly things in his days on the force. I don't know. I guess we're about to find out, but I was just trying to figure out what he was trying to do by investigating. And the only thing I can think of that he was trying to accomplish by investigating this at all, and by even being part of this story, was to destroy the evidence. Because if he's going to continue doing this, he needs to pick up all the loose ends, like the boxes that he mailed to the other fathers, and the phones, and the guns, and the origami figures with the clues. He doesn't want any competent detectives who are investigating this series of murders to eventually interview one of the families of the victims, and find that stuff. So he's probably actually just trying to clean up the loose ends. But I don't know why he would, like, go so crazy on Gordy Kramer. Maybe he actually has a beef with Gordy's father that, like, dates back to his days as a cop, because I can imagine maybe there was an investigation of Gordy's father when he was working on the force, and maybe he botched the case and that's how he got kicked out of the force. So it seems likely that maybe he would just want to find some way to defame the Kramer family now, and what better way than by trying to pin the Origami killings on them? I'm really just speculating at this point. I'm grasping at straws. This game has, in a sense, it's underwhelmed me, and in a sense, it's blown my mind, because some things I totally saw coming, and other things I could never have seen coming in a million years. Like, that doctor was creepy, but the part where he hit Madison on the back of the head with a baseball bat was just, like, that gave me such a scare. And, alright, let's just see what's happening. I've spent enough time hesitating. I'm going to pick up these matches and probably strike them and start setting fire to documents. I've got a nice empty metal trash container. Oh, he's got some scrap newspaper in the bottom of the container to start a nice fire. Here's a letter sent to Alan Winter, the father of, the husband of Lauren Winter. He's got this box from, the convenience store. I wonder what's in it. Is it always 5 origami figures? It might just be an empty box. Here's a flashback of him looking at it and looking at the lizard, which was the 3rd trial. I don't know whether every father gets the same 5 trials or whether he mixes it up a little bit. Here's the phone from Jeremy Bowles' mother. I don't know if you can burn a phone like that. Here's an address book. I think this is Manfred's book of people that he sold. No, that's Paco's book of something. Oh, Paco rented an apartment to him. So he had to destroy the record of that financial transaction, okay. And then there's probably going to be Manfred's book of people who he either sold typewriters to or sold typewriter parts to. Of course, the reason why Manfred was murdered and it looked like there was nobody else in the store is because there was nobody else in the store. When the clock rang and it showed Lauren's reaction to the clock's ringing, Scott dashed into the back room, killed Manfred, and then opened a window to make it look like someone else had done it. Now he's gonna open the window, right? It doesn't show him opening the window, but that's clearly what happened. And now there's a photo of him and his brother. And that's the photo from, it looks like the photo that Madison found in the nursing home. It is the photo that Madison found in the nursing home. So, yeah, right after Madison interviewed his mother, he must have come to see her and for some reason decided to take the photo and destroy the evidence of that so nobody else could, like, visit her at the nursing home. It looked like his mother wasn't moving either. Did his mother die, like, right when he was visiting her? Did he, like, poison his own mother? Well, that was sure a lot of loose ends tied up in one fell swoop. Now we have Madison, who is probably racing like hell to confront the origami killer. She knows his name, so she can probably just look him up in the phone book, right? And Jayden's also racing like hell to confront him because Jayden knows his address. So Ethan has no way to save his son, but I think Madison and Jayden both have a shot at doing it for him. So this is going to be the grand finale where one, both, or none of these characters successfully save Sean and arrest the origami killer once and for all.